Moving on, I would request Mr. Bimal Jindal, who had supply chain at SoftBank. And given the fact that SoftBank is one of the largest players in the Indian renewable sector, and how does he want to cover a few of the points? Karan also raised that 5 years down the line, there could be issues in enforcing supply chain contracts. And what's have been their experience with bids coming in, bids cancelling, and the shaking of investor interest with the bid cancellation despite winning bids. So, and how does he foresee that the SoftBank thing going forward, and also interest from other large international investors? So over to you, Bimal.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Bimal Jindal. I head supply chain for SA Energy, which is part of SoftBank. SoftBank is a Japanese company. They have a diversified interest in capital investments, IT, telecom, and the world vertical. We started our journey in late 2015 in India. And in 3 years, we are a company of 5 gigawatt portfolio in hand. We started our journey with solar. Now we are into wind also. We won one of the biggest solar and wind hybrid. The 450 megawatt bit. I believe you know all the speakers has touched on very interesting topics. Everyone is giving good insights. Like Kapil said, there are a couple of issues which definitely need to be seen when we're talking about 100 gigawatt or 175 gigawatt of renewable setup. The first part, I was just going through some articles a few weeks back when some of the states are talking about canceling PPA, not honoring them for 25-year duration. Even there's a cancellation of reverse auctions in India, which is not a pretty good sign for the investor sentiment. If you look at, I'm just going through the data. 2 years ago, 3 years ago, the number of developers who are bidding for the reverse auctions versus today, it has gone significantly down. The foreign players are becoming very skeptical, I believe, to look into this part. They are a bit concerned how the government is going to act. The policies are also need to be pretty clear. I believe GST, I think Kapil said and someone else also said, is another risk. So government need to come up with the clear transactions, how they want to handle it. Mitesh raised a couple of serious points. There's no focus on renewable funding. Although there's a major focus on power funding, but there's no dedicated channels or a government direction that you need to spend this much or X amount of money on renewable if you're funding 100. So those factors are definitely going to impact the developers. We as a developers are having massive challenge in hand when we go to the financers. We need to look into multiple parameters. I think Mitesh only said we need 2.16 lakh crore. So that is another challenge. No one is realizing the kind of money which we need to build this kind of projects. It's massive. And Indian lenders alone cannot do this funding. Let's understand and accept this fact also. So you need international players. When the international lenders are coming, they look into all this risk. Some of my colleagues touched upon curtailment and the non-payment issues. When the foreign investor or lender is coming into the market and is looking at the PPA and he's saying that, oh, this DISCOM is not paying for X months or X years. What is the security for my payment? How are you going to pay your loans back? So this is going to be a massive concern which need to be seen. Another challenge which developers are facing at this moment, which Ravi touched upon, the industry is shifting from poly to mono. Unfortunately, the Indian industry is not ready for that because of the lower tariffs. We cannot afford mono at this moment. Whatever we say, the project which we bid, this year, next year, they will not be able to survive mono pricing unless it comes reasonable to the volume. So the developers are not getting any incentive to explore the new technologies. Like in China, they have a top-run program where they give special tariff to promote the technology. In India, we don't have that kind of program. We are typically going with the conventional technologies. And if I go to the lender also, the lender says, if you are using a new technology, that is belong to you. Even with the substantial data which you're getting from the third parties, they're not ready to listen. They always try to put a more risk on the developer side. That ultimately reduces, you know, the risk-taking capability of the developer. They also like to go with the conventional, which is not a good sign for the industry when you want to grow for 100 gigawatt or 200 gigawatt, 250 gigawatt by 2030. So this need to be seen from the industry perspective. As Tanya said, you know, that it's a 25-year game. It's not a one-year game. If you're going to build the plants on just a technology for next 25 years, it's not good sign. And I think the quality is one of the major concern when people are bidding lower tariffs. Kapil was touching, Tanya again touched. The developers who want to own the plants, they always look into LCOE. They don't look into the lowest capex. The lowest capex can make the plant, but it will not be able to stand for 25 years. As SV Energy, we are always focused on a quality as a long term. We are going to own our assets for 25 years. I have a massive discussion with all the leading EPC companies. They always debate one thing with me. Vimal, why you guys are spending so much money on the EPC side? Look at the industry, what industry is doing. Why you're not ready to listen? Why you want to pay this premium? The only answer which I give them that we want to hold this plant for 25 years. And we are a long-term investor in this plant. I think another interesting topic which you know is raised by Karan on the contract side, it's not 5 years from now, it's happening right now. I think the people who are dealing with the Chinese, they know that it's not a new thing and it's not happening today. It's happening for the last 2 years. It's happening since beginning. I being Indian, I'm, you know, full go for Make in India, unfortunately, but we don't have the visibility. How that is going to be competitive, how that, you know, the plants is going to come and give a right technology at a competitive price. At this moment, if I look at the Indian solar industry, we are trying to do some steps. They are not good enough from the model perspective. And if I talk about enforceability, your contracts are good. You can talk about ICC, you can talk about LCA, you can talk SIAC. But at the end of the day, enforcing those contracts with a PPA timeline of 12 months, it's impossible. The developer left with no other choice, given the delivery constraint, either he need to, you know, renegotiate and settle or look for alternative because he can't wait for litigation of 2 years. So it's a challenge even today. It's not 5 years from now. We as a industry need to see how to handle this thing. I think there should be, you know, some robust mechanism. It's not like you can't enforce international arbitration in China. But right now, there's no will to enforce. I'm not saying from everyone's perspective, but that's what is happening. If as industry in India, all developers come together and start taking strong action, those guys who are defaulting, it will happen. That's all from my side, Kapil. I think I tried to cover the points which you tried to raise. Thank you.
Thank you, Vimal. I mean, moving on, without, you know, given the time constraint, we'll move on. And thanks for giving a very practical perspective.
Thanks for giving a very practical perspective on how we should look at LCOE and especially supply contracts. I will now ask Mr. Amit Mehta, Vice President, Greenstone Advisory, given his experience in transaction advisory and working with some of the international strategic and institutional investors who want to invest in Indian renewable story, and looking at the projects and advisory right now, how he wants to project challenges, investor outside India look for the renewable story in India, and some of the strategic investors look the way renewable story is presently in India. Amit, over to you.
Great. Thank you, Vimal.
Great. Thanks, Kapil. Obviously, I'm cognizant of the time and we will ensure that we try to keep it short. So I think I work at an iBank that is called Greenstone Advisors. We are focused only on renewable energy and we've been in the space for roughly 5 years since we were like a 2-3 gigawatt solar industry to a 30 gigawatt industry right now. So I would like to touch upon the 2-3 topics that you mentioned about, you know, what international investors are looking for when they intend to come into India. On a very high level, the macro story for India is pretty strong. These issues which are very, very important for developers, IPPs internally, like, you know, receivable cycles or approvals or land, these are definitely like major challenges. But when you look from an outside perspective who's looking for an investor who wants to come and deploy 100 billion, 200 billion, just be a passive investor. For him, there are only 3 or 4 such aspects. These ground level aspects are something that they trust the management, then they would back. For example, like a large pension fund would back a large developer who has already 2-3 gigawatt assets in India. They are fine with them managing the assets and that's the reason they are backing them. So for them, the aspects are not the ground level of the day-to-day concerns. They would look at something which is about that, and that's what I can like try to add apart from the regular things. So I think the 3 key things that we have seen which most international investors look for, one is scale, that is that there has been a transitional shift from like a growth equity type of story to a yield based story that has happened over the last 5 years. Earlier you used to see that there were equity investors, PE guys who were happy to back platforms in smaller scale who would then grow and create that alpha for them. But now it's gone to a stage where majority investors want to back only groups that have achieved some scale. And the transition shift is not from having a high growth of like a high teen return, but to a yield type of a stable return. So that is one thing that has happened and which they believe can be achieved only if the platform has scale. And yes, when you have scale, even this issues of, you know, ground level of receivables management, working capital management, approvals also get mitigated by over a portfolio. So that is one aspect that investors look for. Second is governance, that international guys are, and regardless of our renewable industry or energy industry, are wary of the fact about certain governance issues in emerging markets, and India is no different story. So that is another angle that they are very, very kind of keen on to look at when they do their, you know, initial checks, discussions with management and how the kind of the platform is being run. And the third is obviously exit. So while this exit has been now mitigated to a certain level with majority yield players like pension funds, sovereign funds trying to, you know, get into this sector, and the exit horizon has been much longer from them, that is 15-20 years and not the 6-8 year private equity type of horizons those guys had. So that I think are the 2-3 key factors which these international investors look, apart from, let's say, the ground level things about technical aspects, about quality of the management, about regulatory strength that they have, operational expertise. Over time, people are asking questions about what is the operational expertise this platform has, because they believe that once a project is constructed, fair enough, it was made good, but then if it is not managed well, it will not return what was projected in that Excel. So the operational expertise is also one more angle that is coming out and being questioned by investors as well. So that's, I think, primarily what is there on the investor side, when we speak with a lot of people on the equity raising side. We'll just touch upon 2-3 comments on the M&A angle also, that is the other line of business that we cover. So on the M&A piece, see the market, the growth in the entire market has primarily been organic. It's not been a great M&A market if you look over the last 5 years. There has been hardly 5-6 gigawatt of M&As that have happened, which has also been dominated by 3 or 4 large transactions of 1 gigawatt. Balance 2-3 gigawatts have been those small scale M&As, and which we also personally believe is going to be the way ahead, that the small scale M&As are going to face those challenges. And that is primarily driven due to technical quality mismatch between what is represented and then what is actually at the site. There is this valuation mismatch between the seller and the buyer, which is always there. And structuring, which has always been a concern, where some assets were poorly structured in terms of SPVs in India, SPVs offshore, and then getting those capital gains taxes, etc. So these small-scale M&As, while there are groups who are seeking exit in this smaller market of sub-50 megawatts, we believe will be a challenge. M&As of this 500 megawatt plus 1 gigawatt plus, where developers who are either seeking capital to grow or seeking capital to monetize their platform will be, I would not say easier M&As, but the M&As that will see the success at the end. Otherwise, you can go back and there have been over 3 gigawatt of processes that have been run by various bankers over the last 2 years, which have not seen the light at the end of the tunnel. So that way, I think M&A on the larger scale would, I would say, those deals are complex, but would happen because there is enough meat in them for groups to, you know, keep looking at it. The smaller scale M&A would try to have some challenge. So those are the two aspects that we primarily cover in some angles. That's us.
Trying to manage within time. Thanks, Anand, for your clock ticking and reminding. So thank you so much, Amit, for bringing in perspective not only from transaction advisory or global perspective, but also how the M&A sector looks in India, which has been seeing some interesting shifts with rooftop platforms being also getting investor interest now, apart from some of the utility platforms. We've discussed enough on some of the operational issues from legal, financing, infrastructure, plant quality, etc. And here, as a moderator of the session, I would like to leave everyone with a couple of thought process which we have touched upon during the panel discussion, but also some points which were not touched upon. Given the scale, we have reached 30 gigawatt. It's time we should look whether it can be 24/7 renewable power. So start thinking from now if we really want to take it to 100, not only 100 gigawatt, but even more. We should also think, given the fact that global auto companies are coming up with energy supply divisions, so how do we converge energy and mobility at this point of time, given the fact e-mobility would come in future? And also on a distributed sector, when the time will come that I produce the energy on my own roof and I supply it to my neighbor as and when he needs, I sign a contract and there's a complete blockchain of network which allows me to trade power, allows me to buy power at any given point of time. It's on me when I generate, at what point I purchase and what point I sell and at what price I sell, when the entire blockchain concept will come in the distributed energy sector. And apart from that, what are the emerging technologies within the present set of projects, what we are doing, let's say wind, solar, hybrid, floating solar, etc. So I'm sure some of these points would be covered also in the next sessions, what are gonna come. But given the time limits, I would still say if any panelist, starting from Brijesh, want to just take 30 seconds for the closing remark, you're open to. And otherwise, we'll go for Q&A.
Yeah, I want to make one point, Karan. What you're saying about Chinese contract, even we are facing problem with some Indian module manufacturer on the DCR side. It's becoming impossible to enforce them, the contract. So that's what I would like to say.
Any company which has defaulted to financial or operational creditors can be taken to the IBC, other than, of course, banks and NBFC, for which there's a separate code being enacted. So in short, you obviously would not qualify as a financial creditor. You probably meet the merits as an operational creditor. And once you meet those merits, subject to the provision of the code, depending on certain other factors, it should be doable.
We are all looking at all the negatives, but we also have to look at that we have built a large scale portfolio here. We've done a lot in the last 10 years, and we're now in the journey to do way more. So while we deal with each of these complexities daily and they bog our head, if we step back, I think we deserve a pat on the back.
Thanks, Tanya.
Just to add, what Tanya said, till 2017, I think we did 10 gigawatt, and then doing 20 gigawatt, you know, shows government's vision and industry commitment. I think we must appreciate we are on the right track. And when you try to do something new, there is always a challenge. So let's face the challenge and move forward. Thank you.
That's like all the discussions, all the negative and pain points comes first, and then the positive starts coming towards the end. Amit, you want to add something?
No, I think as rightly said by Tanya, that it's a way to move ahead where we were and who are. And I think the other sectors such as rooftop, offshore wind, should be the ones where you see these things and you, and that is actually good for everybody to even diversify throughout the entire renewable energy chain. Or sustainability theme is more important rather than what asset class. If we can go towards the entire, even efficiency would add a lot of things to that. So if we look on a holistic level, renewables, I think that will be like a great story ahead.